Good evening. Good evening.
Good evening.
Glad y'all could make it out this evening.
Amen.
I got sidetracked this morning. I wanted to apologize for getting sidetracked, not turning on the sound. And I forgot some of the bulletin, too, on top of it because of that. We need participants for the Easter play coming up. I think we need about maybe 10 adults, and they're small parts, not very big parts. And we really do need someone. We only got 2 people to sign up, so check your hearts, check your prayers, and get some people out to volunteer for the play. I'm going to volunteer, so I have someone take my place. So if that's any consolation, help, whatever, I'm willing to do it. So, and I'm not a speaking person, so you're lucky you got me up here. But that's my job. I got to do it. Thank you, Lord. Welcome, guests. We're hoping you're all open your hearts and let God come in. If you're a guest, we have a, on your bulletin, there's a little questionnaire and pamphlet there to fill out and drop in the offering plate. And we'd appreciate it if you do that. Let us know about your visit and your concerns. Scripture verse of the week. Joshua took a great stone and set it up under an oak. That was by the sanctuary of the Lord. And Joshua said unto all the people, "Behold, this stone shall be a witness unto us, for it hath heard all the words of the Lord, which he spoke unto us. It shall be therefore a witness unto you, lest ye deny your God." Joshua 24, 26, and 27. Pray for Kirkwood Church this week. Word of the day: a truly humble man is sensible of his natural distance from God, of his dependence on him, of the inefficiencies of his own power and wisdom, and it is by God's power that he is upheld and provided for, and that he needs God's wisdom to lead and guide him, and his might to enable him to do what he ought to do for him. That was by Jonathan Edwards. Had a fellowship meal this morning after service. If you missed that, you missed a good meal, and a happy birthday for Fred. It was really good to see Fred out and to be here for his birthday. Was a pleasure. Deacons met this evening. Baptist women met also this evening. We do have a business meeting Wednesday. Trustees will present a proposal to redecorate and do some remodeling to the church building for updating and upkeep, and for financing the project. And children's Sunday school class on February 11 will have Jesus Loves Me class time party with refreshments. Senior day out, February 19th, to the Bread of Life for lunch. This place was not started by Tasty Rolls, but by the love one couple had for the children. That is run all by children, too, down there. Matter of fact, I think it's an orphan or a children's home. Actually, the children that work there, that gives them an opportunity to earn money and to learn about business and people, and gets them out. We do thank you for your continued support for ongoing ministries, Christmas Child Shoebox Ministry, and Bags of Hope Food Pantry. And if you know anyone that does need assistance with food, second Tuesday of each month, downstairs, and they hand out food down there. That's something else I forgot too. Forgot prayer this morning. I apologize for that also. I'd like to close with a prayer. Dear Lord, we do thank you again for another opportunity to be in your home, to hear the words that God has for us. We ask you, Lord, that you'd be Brother Lynn, fill him full of the Holy Spirit, give him the words we need to hear, to take to our community, to do our job as people of fellowship and disciples of you. We just thank you again for your son, Jesus, who saved us and gave us these words that we know to live by. Thank you again, Father. In your name I pray. Amen.
Good evening, everybody. All right, I
Let's all stand, turn page 135, Nothing But the Blood. Page 575, I will sing of my Redeemer.
Suffered from the cross.
Let's pray. Dear gracious, loving Heavenly Father, Lord, thank you for another wonderful evening back in your house, Heavenly Father. Please be with Brother Lynn this evening as he brings us your word, Lord. Please be with those who couldn't make it and those who are sick, Heavenly Father. Watch over all them. Please be with all the children. Please watch over Jerusalem and Israel and protect them, Heavenly Father. And all these things in Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
Your grace has found me just as I am, empty hand above loving hands. We're singing. Yeah. praise you, oh God.
Turn with me to the book of Micah. Micah chapter 5. And while you're turning, share a little story with you. Police department got a call, sent an officer over to a couple's house. And he got to the house and went in, and the lady had shot her husband. She had mopped the floor and he got on it while it was wet. He went back out to the cruiser, called back down to station, gave a report. This lady's killed her husband for stepping on the wet floor that she just mopped. The chief said, "Did you arrest her?" He said, "No, the floor is still wet." All right, let's turn to turn to Micah chapter 5, and let's stand in reverence to the Lord. Micah chapter 5, begin with verse 1. Thus saith the Lord. Now gather thyself in troops, O daughter of troops, hath laid siege against us. They shall smite the judge of Israel with a rod upon the cheek. But thou, Bethlehem, Ephrathah, though thou be little among the thousands of Judah, yet out of thee shall he come forth unto me that is to be ruler in Israel, whose goings forth have been made from of old, from everlasting. Therefore he will give them up until that time that she which travaileth hath brought forth, then the remnant of his brethren shall return unto the children of Israel. And he shall stand and feed in the strength of the Lord, in the majesty of the name of the Lord his God, and they shall abide, for now shall he be great unto the ends of the earth. And this man shall be the peace when the Assyrians shall come into our land, and when he shall tread in our palaces, then shall we rise again him 7 shepherds and 8 principal men, and they shall waste the land of Assyria with the sword, and the land of Nimrod in the entrances thereof. Thus shall he deliver us from the Assyrian when he cometh into our land and when he treadeth within our borders. Let's pray, please. Our Heavenly Fathers, we bow our hearts before you again tonight. We just come thanking you for the privilege that we do have. Father, without fear of life or limb, gather here in your presence tonight. Father, I thank you for the hunger that's within the hearts of those that are here. And Father, I do believe that there is a hunger within their hearts that they're here. And Father, I pray that you will allow us to hear your voice tonight, that you, upon the blessing of your word, will reveal yourself to us, that you will help us with understanding, that you will continually bestow your blessings upon us, that we will continually move forward for thine glory. Father, I just praise you and thank you for all the many blessings in this life, and ask that you hide me and use me behind the cross of Calvary and use me as your mouthpiece tonight for thine glory. Father, we do love you. We praise you. We thank you for all things, for so many blessings of life. As we talked about this morning, here to there, from there to there. And Father, I thank you for all things, but most of all for Jesus, for the precious sacrifice of his blood on Calvary. Father, may you, by the blessing of your word, bless us tonight in all that we hear. Lord, we would take it with us throughout this week and use it, Lord, to honor you, to bring glory to you, and bearing witness and testimony of who we are in being your. We love you, we thank you, we praise you, and pray and ask it all In Jesus' name, amen.
So tonight, as I said this morning, we're going to be looking at Micah's vision of the future based on past promises. Isn't it a blessing to know that on behalf of the past promises that God made us, we can continue to look forward in that. You know, as we look back at chapter 4, we had talked about the prophecy of the last days, but here in chapter 5, Micah is based on those past promises, looking into the future. He is going to reveal to us this prophecy about the first coming of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. In verse 1, we see, first of all, the insult of that. The insult of what took place here and what he's saying. Zedekiah is and was the last king of the Davidic kingdom. He's going to be smitten. And the way we find that out is because when Nebuchadnezzar came in, Jehoiakim had rebelled and being placed as ruler there in Jerusalem. And because he rebelled, Jehoiachin was put in place. And because he rebelled, Zedekiah was put in place. And he got tired of fooling with these kings in place of ruling and done some pretty terrible things to Zedekiah, didn't he? He actually put his eyes out. Before he put his eyes out, he killed his two sons. And so the enemy, you might say, was at the wall without a commander inside to help them. The enemy was at the walls outside with a commander inside to help them. When one forgets about God, when one puts God on the back burner, that being a leader, regardless of who he's leading, whether it be the leader of a nation, the leader of a church, a leader of a Sunday school class, a man that's leader of his family, when he puts God on the back burner or forgets about God in that manner, it's the same principle here. The enemy is on the outside of the wall without that leader being there for the good of the people that are in need of the Lord Jesus Christ. And it's a dangerous thing. And so in that, the point being is that the Lord got tired of his people rebelling. And I'm thankful, I'm reminded today in that of how that's happened in our society. I believe the Lord has got tired of false leaders, and I call them false leaders, and because they weren't willing to lead according to the ways of God, God put somebody else in place. We know for a fact, when we do the study of what's going on across our entire country here in America, that false leaders have been put into positions of our schools and universities, and they're leading people down the wrong road. It's happening within our own country with many leaders, but every Christian, whether we're weak or strong, is commanded to arise and be ready. He says, don't let the enemy prevail. Do not let the enemy prevail. That's what he's out to do. He's out to, again, stop and hinder the work of God. And he'll do anything with anybody he can. Every soldier, that being you and I, is to close the ranks and hold his place. I want us to think about that for a minute. Every soldier is to be there and close the ranks and hold their place. Well, let me ask you a question. How in the world can every soldier do that if they're not present? How can they do that if they're not there? How can they do that if they're not showing up? How can they do that if they're a part of the body that's supposed to keep the ranks closed to keep the enemy out and for the leader to lead if the soldiers aren't showing up? It's hard. And it leads to the very same thing that's happening here in the time of Micah. And so this insult is the shameful treatment of Zedekiah. And Israel was going to feel the shame, brought to her on behalf of her leaders and the sin in which she was allowing to happen in the country at that time. And so, but the point of the matter is this, is just because we get knocked down sometimes and face defeat at times does not mean that God's through with us. That's a positive note to see in this scripture tonight. You know, just because they weren't willing to listen to God, just because the leaders weren't the leaders that they ought to have been, just because many of the soldiers, many of the people, the nation weren't what they ought to be in closing the ranks, doesn't mean that God's through with you. If you're willing to, as we said this morning, come to that place of repentance in your life on behalf of what's going on in opposition to God, God's going to bless you. God's going to put you back. God's going to bring you back into the rank. God's going to close that form up to where it will keep that protection that needs to be there. One might think at this moment in her own country, and at this time, I'm sure they probably thought the same thing, that God's promise had probably come to an end. I mean, here they were, a nation of people that had went into the land, and God had asked, as we talked about this morning when Joshua led them in, to be that people of influence, to don't let those people that are in this land influence you, but you influence them. And but they didn't do it. But as we think about God's promise maybe coming to an end, we know that, again, we look at what Micah is seeing in the future based on past promises. And the promise was, as we know it, that God had made an Abrahamic covenant with Abraham, and we know that God's promise is going to follow through. We talked about that last week and how the devil always wants to hinder, and he can hinder according to the life that we live if we let him. But there's one thing for certain. He might hinder, he might slow down the work of God, but he cannot and he will not stop the word of God. God's promises will be fulfilled, and it's going to happen. And so the devil just tries to keep it from happening sometimes. But, you know, just as we think that God's promise here maybe had come to an end, verse 2 here is a remarkable, remarkable, most remarkable verse, because it talks about the incarnation. The incarnation of the living God. And that's why I titled the message what I did, because this passage talks about that being which is little but strong. That which is little but strong. When Christ was birthed into this world, he came as a little child, but he was still the King of Kings. He was the Majesty, and he still is today. And he will always remain to be your Majesty, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Little but strong. And, you know, sometimes people and sometimes nation and most certainly the enemy sometimes doesn't realize this. They think they have the upper hand, you might say. And sometimes they don't realize that this one which might have been little in coming is very strong. Bethlehem was little among the thousands of Judea there in Judah. Isaiah 7:14 foretells the virgin birth of our Lord, and Micah here foretells the place where he's going to be born. And Bethlehem, only being about 6 miles southwest of Jerusalem, actually meaning house of bread, was a very small place, but was going to come to be very, very famous one day. Those of you that have been to the Holy Land, those of you that hear about that place there in Bethlehem, the birthplace of our Lord, has become a world famous place because of this little one that is so strong. You know, sometimes it's that little place or that which may seem insignificant that becomes so important. And just to try to get a point across, I was watching Death Valley Days last night. I don't watch a lot of TV, but I did watch two or three episodes last night, and I love Death Valley Days. Anybody ever watch that? They tell true stories. And he was telling last night, there was this story about the true story of Levi Stratus. And I don't know if you know the story or not, but Levi Stratus and his family lived in Germany. And he left Germany and was going to New York, and his brother was going to send him goods, and he was going to start a linen shop there in New York. Well, they on the way over in the voyage, the ship got damaged some way, and it damaged some of the materials or something that he was going to use to start the business with, and all he had left was some canvas. And the business didn't get started off as he anticipated it would, and things were very, 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 very hard for them. And he decided, well, I'm going to go, because he had heard about out west this gold rush thing. And so he left and went out west trying to find some gold. That didn't go over. He came back to San Francisco, I believe it was. And in San Francisco, he was down to just absolutely nothing. And him and his partner went into this shop and rented a building with what little gold he had found out in San Francisco, out west, I guess in San Francisco, and rented this shop and was going to start this business. Didn't have anything to start with but a little bit of canvas. And so he said, well, what I'll do is I'll go down to the bank, because they rented a shop on the main street of town. I'll go down to the bank and borrow some money. And so his partner told him, he said, well, you can't go down there looking like that, because he looked rough coming back from, that the gold field, gold mine, trying to dig up some gold. And he said, you're going to have to go present yourself better than this. And so he came up with the idea of taking that canvas and dyeing that canvas to make himself a suit. And so he made himself a suit, and he said, this looks pretty nice, but he said, I can't go down here to the bank and walk into the banker and have a document that I'm just holding in my hand. I need a pocket to put that document into. And so he was going to put a pocket on the back of his pants. And long story short, he ended up riveting those pockets on the pants. And he went down to the bank. He didn't get the loan. But on the way back, as he's walking down the street, he ran into some guys, and long story short again, they noticed his riveted back pockets. And he began to make, some said, well, I'd like to have a pair of them. Another said, I'd like to have a pair of them. And there was a group of them followed him into the store, and he began to take orders, and that's how he got started and became a millionaire. And I just tell you that to say this, never underestimate God, regardless of who we are. Just like God was little, but he's strong. In that same sense, by that same principle, God can take us. And sometimes we may feel like we get knocked down. But there's always that opportunity for God to use us to become that person that God wants us to be for the glory of God. And so let us keep that in mind. And that's how it kind of works. It was probably hard for some to believe that Bethlehem was going to be so important. But that is how it works. God didn't choose to be born in Athens, Greece, very well-known, popular place. God didn't choose to be born in Alexandria of Egypt. He didn't choose to be born in Rome or London or Paris or Washington, D.C. He chose to be born in Bethlehem, this small place. And again, being little, but becoming very, very important. Why Bethlehem? To become the ruler of Israel and to be born the king of the Jews. So God appeared to Abraham, to Jacob, to Joshua, and the three in the furnace. So do we realize that he will meet with us just as he did with them in the time of need? Come to us in our poor, wretched state when we are in the state that we're in. And when we trust him, he will go with us and abide with us forever. And then we look at the interval. Micah says, between my time and his time, between the time that I'm having this vision and the time that the Lord's going to come, he said, there's going to be this interval. He said, there's going to be like if you're watching a movie and there's a commercial or an intermission. He said, in between my time and the time that he's going to come, he says, during that time, Judah is going to lose sovereignty. First to Assyria, then to Babylon, then to the Persians, then to the Greeks. And then after that, Judah actually became a political football because it got tossed back and forth between Syria and Egypt. But you get the understanding here, evil times had fallen upon the capital city of Jerusalem. Evil times has fallen upon our country, the United States of America. The woman Micah saw in pain was that nation of Israel. I truly believe that it is known today that we are in pain as a people of our country. During this commercial break, Micah says the royal family of David is going to shrink. It's not going to appear to be as important as what it used to be. It's not going to be the same as it used to be. And you and I both know, as the way things are and the way things are escalating, it's not going to be the same anymore for us, at least until the Lord comes. But based on past promises, visualizing what we know in the future, and by what Micah has seen, we know that our Lord's going to return, and it's going to be better. But he says, until the young poor virgin girl and the Nazarene carpenter shows up for the birth of Christ. And so we can look forward to that. In verses 4 through 6, he talks about the installation. Micah sees Jesus reigning as a shepherd. He sees the Lord reigning as a shepherd. David was God's king shepherd. Shepherd king, rather, in the Old Testament. Kingship meant one who pastors. One who protects. One who provides. And that's who God was. That's who David was. That's who David was in being a shepherd. That's who God was in his coming, going to be and is and forevermore will be. Actively engaged, that being the one in kingship. Always ready to watch, feed, and defend from the heathen nations until the end. In Psalm 22, we find the suffering shepherd, that being our Lord. In Psalm 23, we find the sustaining shepherd, that being our Lord. In Psalm 24, we find the sovereign shepherd, that being our Lord. Micah could see the Lord, the great shepherd of the sheep, standing, feeding his flock, daring that anyone intervene. I mean, how precious it is to know of this one that was so little, so small, to come to be so great, so strong, that would watch over us and protect us and provide for us in the sense that he has. And as we talked about that this morning, looking back from here to there, and from here to there, and from there to there, how he has, by his promises, past promises based, or past promises based on the future enlightenment in which he gives us by the revelation of God's word. In verse 5 and 6, when the enemy came into the land to waste Israel, the great shepherd will deliver them. Just like when they got things right. When they got things right, we talked about that this morning from the book of 1 Samuel. When they done what was right, then God stepped in. In verse 6 here, in our passage, it speaks of the future, pointing to the return of Christ and also pointing to the establishment of the millennial kingdom. In Micah's day, Assyria was a great enemy. Assyria was another name for war, for cruelty, for oppression. The Old Testament prophets used the word Assyria as a title for the Antichrist, which was a mantle for ruthlessness. Ruthlessness, in which we see a lot of today. Micah references the last day enemy. Micah sees the alliance of nations with goals to exterminate the people of Israel. Do I have to say any more about what's going on today? As Micah was seeing into the future, Micah was seeing into our day and time based on past promises by what God said was going to happen. By the prophecy in which God showed Micah, in this day and time, this is going to happen. not only by Assyria, not only by Babylon, not only by the Persians and the Greeks and so on and so forth, but in our day and time, exactly what's happening in with Russia, with Iran, with Turkey, with all of these countries around which are persecuting. As Micah sees this alliance of nations with the goal to exterminate the people of Israel, he may have gotten a glimpse of Ezekiel 38 and 39. About the war of Damascus being annihilated. But regardless, Israel's shepherd, he says, will come, will rescue the end time troubles. In verse 5, he talks about the seven shepherds and the eight principles. The Lord will raise up men to be his instruments to overcome the evil in these last days. Men that will be teaching truth and always facing warfare. I pray that that's us today. I pray that that is us today. I pray that that's you and me. He may specifically be talking about leaders that are raising up, but I think he's talking about his army of men that closes in and holds the fort, holds the enemy back. And so maybe we do that in teaching the truth, facing warfare. You know, the truth is, my friends, there are very few people, and I know that many of you know this, but there are very, 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 and I say very few people understand spiritual warfare. They have no earthly idea what it really is. Yeah. They do not know, they do not realize that we're working against the darkness and the principalities of this world, the evil ways of Satan. They fail to understand this. And the more the gospel spreads in the community and the world, the more bitter the spirit of unbelief and ungodliness becomes. And it's coming. I talk about this and I talk about this and I'll continue to talk about this because it is coming. If you are a born-again believer, you better hold on to your faith. You better stand solid on the foundation because the time is coming, if not already here, in many places you can go. That you will be discriminated, or you will be mocked, or you will be made fun of, or somebody will say something against you because of your stand in Jesus Christ. Amen. And we have to stand strong. I cannot emphasize that enough. But as he talks about these seven plus the eight principle, he's talking about seven, of course, in the Bible means completeness, plus one just simply means there's going to be more than enough to do the job. Well, the more than enough to do the job is going to be the Lord himself.
Right.
Because he said in Samuel this morning, we read that the Israeli army, the Israelites, before they went out to fight the Philistines, that the Lord just thundered and just frightened those Philistines to death. The Bible says that in the end times, when the Lord returns, and this thing really comes down, and all these countries that are gathered around Israel that are going to try to exterminate and try to annihilate his people, that God is going to, that fast, annihilate them. You're talking about people thinking about Jesus and being who he is with such less, or may I say it like that, less understanding of who he is, but how great, how powerful, and what he can do by what he says he will do, whether it's to protect or to provide or whatever it might be in the way that God wants to. In verse 5 and 6, literally, spiritually, this promise belongs to the whole church, to you and I. This man, he says, will give peace to his people. Without his peace, you know and I know, and we talked somewhat about that this morning. Without his peace, the soul is dissatisfied.
Amen.
A soul cannot be satisfied without the peace of God. Not only can it be dissatisfied, but it's restless. A soul is filled with fear, with anxiety, with a sense of guilt. All these things because there's no real satisfaction of who God is in one's life, because there's no real peace of God in one's life, because they have not chosen the peace of God. The inner life of a person is in prayer for peace. Do we not always pray for that? Isn't that what he tells us to pray for? Pray for the peace of Jerusalem. Do we not always pray for peace within our own families? Peace within the church? Peace to live our lives as God would have us to live? Everything points to God as the only satisfaction needed by his children. Trusting Christ, he reconciles us to God. You know that. We've been justified by Christ, through Christ, reconciled to God, given that privilege and honor to approach our Heavenly Father by his righteousness. Not only has he, through Christ, reconciled us and justified us, but he gives us that peace with God. And he gives us that peace within our conscience of knowing God. And we have peace above with God in that sense, with us. As I said this morning, we know where to find him. We can find him here, we can find him here, we can find him here. In the places that we can find our Lord. Within us, in our conscience, around us, with our believers. In verse 3, he says, give them up. Notice what he's saying here. This is a very important part of this passage. You know, we talk about those that trust the Lord, that follow the Lord, that experience the strength of the Lord, that experience the peace of God. But in verse 3, he says, in those words, give them up, meaning into the hands of the enemy. Notice what he's saying. Do you realize that the vast majority that was taken into captivity never returned? The vast majority of those that were taken into captivity never left captivity. You know, Zerubbabel took a group back. Ezra took a group back. You know, there was some of them, there were several of them went back. But the vast majority of them stayed in captivity. They stayed, even though given a choice to return, they remained where they were unwillingly. And that is the problem with America today. They have a choice. You can remain in captivity. You can remain living for yourself. You have that choice of choosing the world or the Lord. And God gives you that free will choice. They were shut out from the land of promise because of their choice. And the Bible teaches us that so many people are going to be shut out from the land, that being the kingdom of God, that being paradise, that being heaven. So many people are going to be shut out because of their decision, because of their choice to stay in captivity. It ought to break our hearts. It ought to have us on our knees crying for God to rekindle the hearts and our fire for him, for his glory, and for the need of those around us. But they were shut out of not only the land of promise, but shut out from the hope of their fathers. They were given up to follow their own ways. The fullness of God's gift was withdrawn from them. May we thank God tonight as children of God that those promises are not withdrawn from us. Till the time be fulfilled that virgin should birth a son that they could look forward to. But so many of them just never saw it, never got it. We've got a world full of people like that tonight. I know that you understand it. I can't say it any more plain than that. I know that we understand it. But my friends, there are a vast majority of people, I say this, so often, so many people that you know, so many people that I know, so many of our family members, I'm sure, that have no idea of this little Christ becoming the king that he was when he came, reigning today. And by their rejecting his way, remaining in captivity, will be shut off from these promises that he has made to you and I that we can look forward to. It's a wonderful thing, my friends, for you and I to sit here tonight and know of all the promises God has made us. It's so wonderful for us tonight to sit here and think about some of the things that we talked about this morning after death and being in the presence of our Lord. Being at the throne of God, seeing the face of Jesus, seeing all these things that we talked about there. But so many people without that understanding and their need for him. You know, it almost appears like the people that were taken into captivity got there and so got so comfortable, I guess, got so adapted to the life in which they were living there that they just didn't seem to care about the way that God had promised them what they could have if they were just willing to surrender to do what he wanted them to do, to experience the blessings. So as our worship team comes tonight, by our suffering shepherd, by our sustaining shepherd, and our sovereign shepherd, and the guarantee of the security that we have, let us praise God for that tonight. But as we praise God for that, let us remember there are so many people in our world, in our society, and my friends, I'm going to say it, there are so many people, I'm sure, that sit in church every Sunday, maybe, that are just like those that remained in captivity, and they're in need of the Lord. May we hear the voice of God to continue to do what God would have us to do. Tonight, if you have a need, you know as well as I do, you can come and kneel at the altar, you can come, I'll pray with you. You have that need, Jesus is the only one to come to for that need. So you come as we stand and sing. What number? 320. Let's stand, please.
Kenny Cole, would you lead us in a word of prayer this message?
Thank you. cleared up exactly 657.
It took that long to empty that water here, yeah.
Yeah.